Today we're going to be going through a great message that God put on my heart today, and today is the Sabbath, so happy Sabbath to everyone. Now, I know some people might be asking, well, what do you mean today is the Sabbath? Today is Monday. How is this the Sabbath? Well, we'll do a whole study on it in this series, because this is going to be a series of Bible studies. We're going to be talking about a lot of topics and a lot of different things to really teach you some techniques, that's my business mind jumping in there, I apologize, but teach you some scriptures, teach you some things about the Bible that may not be taught a lot out there. So you're going to be learning some very specific things that we're going to be going through today. But we're going to answer that question. And how we know it's the Sabbath day is based on the moon. When you understand how God made the heavens and earth years ago, he made the sun, moon, and stars for signs, seasons, days, and years. Which signs and seasons, days, and years are our calendar. If you look at our calendar, we have signs, seasons, days, and years on it. And so it's God's calendar. And a lot of people don't know that. But we're starting to expose this information. We've been exposing it for about 7 years. And now God's really wanting us to really get this message out there so people can understand why it's so important. So today's Bible study is the truth will set you free. We always talk about that. Everybody likes to rattle that sentence off. The truth will set you free. And so we're going to look at it from a biblical perspective, what it actually means to be set free. And so we're going to be going through this. And like I said, this is a series, so you want to come back every week and watch this or listen to this message again, because every week we're going to be building on top of it, on top of each other. So it says here, everybody that's online, our email is savedbytruthministry@gmail.com. If you want to send in your email, what I can do is send you a copy of the scriptures from this message and access to the video. But it says here, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. We all know that scripture. No one will make it to the Father except through Jesus. We know that's a scripture in the Bible, and it's absolutely true that he is the way to the kingdom of God. He is the truth, and he is the life that we're supposed to live. But it's interesting, when Jesus was preaching his message a lot, one of the ways he started a sentence is, I tell you the truth. A lot of the times Jesus would talk, when someone would give their opinion of what the Bible says or what's supposed to happen, they criticized him on the Sabbath, they criticized him on a lot of different things, and Jesus would start off his sentence by saying, I tell you the truth, which implies that what they just said was probably a lie, or was probably not the truth. And so he always started that way. So we're going to look at some of those types of scriptures today of what that actual truth is so we can see it. We're going to look at some of the Bible truths, which is going to basically show some of the false doctrines that so many believers are living by, including ourselves. I was looking at this list of things that Jamie and I, my wife, we had learned over the last, well, now it's been 7 years, but back then it was 4 years when we wrote this document. And it was a whole list of all this stuff that we had been taught in our church and taught over the years. And we realized that most of that was false teaching. And, you know, God started revealing to us what the true teachings are. And so we're going to be going through that today. So one of the most important things that we must remember when we want to live a Christian life is that the Bible says that the righteous will live by faith. Right? And we've been talking about faith today. And so that's one of the things we got to look at, is that the righteous will live by faith. The righteous will live by faith. So let's go to Galatians 3. If you're looking at this online, you can see the scriptures. If you're just listening to it, you can write them down and then, of course, look at them in your Bible. Galatians 3. We will be going through a few scriptures today, a bunch of them, and discussing some of them very importantly, you know, in a very important way. So Galatians 3, starting at verse 10. It says, for all who rely on the works of the law are under a curse, as it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue to do everything written in the book of the law. This is very important. We're not going to go through this right now, but you'll see this, come back to this, so why I'm emphasizing it. You notice it says book of the law. It doesn't say the law, it says the book of the law. And we're not going to talk about all the details of that, because the Ten Commandments were not written in a book. The Ten Commandments were written on stone. This is Moses' law, what it was talking about, because a lot of people, this is a big deception of Satan that he goes through. We're not going to talk about this week, but I just wanted to touch it because next week we will be going over it. It says, clearly no one who relies on the law is justified before God, because the righteous will live by faith. That's the point of the message I wanted to talk about today, is that the righteous will live by faith. It says, the law is not based on faith. On the contrary, it says the person who does these things will live by them. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us, for it was written, cursed is everyone who hung on a pole. So I just wanted you to see that the righteous will live by faith. And that's what we're going to be talking about, is what it means to live by faith. Because if we don't live by faith, then the Bible says we are unrighteous in Scripture. And we're not going to go even over the details of what righteousness means. But we will show it in Scripture. Because I don't like to throw my opinion out there of what we think things mean. We just let the Bible do the talking. The Bible will answer that question for us. So the first thing we got to realize is that the righteous will live by faith. The second thing is that, let's go to Hebrews 11. Hebrews 11. Hebrews 11. Starting in verse 1. So we have to really understand the definition of faith. Because a lot of people have a misunderstanding of what faith actually even means. So let's look at what the scripture says faith means. Faith in action. Now, faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. So God said, let there be light, and he made light. He said, let there be stars in the vast of the sky, and there was vast stars in the vast of the sky. It wasn't made by some big boom or something that people, you know, come up with. This is how the universe was made. We have to believe that. See, when faith takes no evidence, science takes evidence. See, faith doesn't. Based on the scriptures, we need to believe in what the scripture says and not necessarily what we believe or what we've been taught. And that's what we're going to talk about today. Verse 4 says, by faith, Abel brought a better offering than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offering. And by faith, Abel still speaks even though he is dead. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life, so he did not experience death. He cannot be found because God has taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. Look at the next sentence. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. So the message that we have today about this is very important, is that without faith, it's improbable to please God, right? No, it's impossible to please God without faith. So that's very important to understand. It's impossible to please God without faith. This is why this is so important, because as we start going through this Bible study, the things that we're going to be seeing, a lot of them will require faith. It doesn't require something that you've seen before. You have to look at what the scripture says and obey that. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. So let's go through a couple things. The first one I want to talk about is, did you guys know that Satan has false apostles? You know that, and says that in scriptures? In other words, people that teach God's word that the Bible says that are false, that are actually following Satan, not following God. A lot don't realize that that's happening, or that may even be existing today. But we're going to look at the scriptures, because Satan has his own followers. And Satan has his own ministers. Well, let's look and see what the Bible says about that. And the reason why this is so important, because as we start going through these lessons over the next few weeks, we need to be able to recognize truth from false. And it's also another word that Satan uses, deceit, or we use about Satan, or God uses about Satan, is deception. And what is deception? What is deception? Yeah, a lot of times about deception, it looks true. It looks real. It looks like the real McCoy. Kind of like counterfeit money. Counterfeit money is a deception. It's not a lie. It's a deception. I'll give you an example. If I walked up to you and handed you a stack of $100 bills of Monopoly money, how many of you would be deceived by that? Well, I mean, unless you were not 100% upstairs, but most people won't be deceived by thinking that Monopoly money is real money because it doesn't even look real, right? It doesn't even appear to be real. But deception is a counterfeit $100 bill. If I handed you a stack of counterfeit and someone was an excellent counterfeiter and we handed you those bills, you wouldn't know the difference. You couldn't tell the difference because you don't know the difference between counterfeit and real, because it might just be one little line. It might just be the color of the paper under a certain light. Yeah, and that may be true. And it's changed over the years, many different times. How bills are made, they're always changed every year. Why? Because the counterfeiters stay up with the real bills. They stay up with them. So we got to understand how to read those counterfeits. And the same thing in scriptures. We're going to see that in a little bit, because people will take Satan will take a scripture and twist it just a little, just enough so it's deception and you could be off. You know, it says it's a wide road and most people won't find it. It's a narrow road that leads to life. So if it's a narrow road, that means most aren't going to find it, right? And that's only because of deception, because Satan's deception that he's put into the scriptures. Because he can't deceive him with different books, book that's not the Bible. He's going to deceive us in the scriptures. And we're going to look at that right now. Let's go over to 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians 11. 2 Corinthians 11, and we're going to start in verse 1. It says, I hope you will put up with me a little foolishness. Yes, please put up with me. I am jealous for you with a godly jealousy. I promise you one husband to Christ so that I might present you as a pure virgin to him. That's a whole other study we'll do about the 10 virgins and how what this all means. But it says, but I am afraid that just as Eve was deceived by the serpent's cunning, your minds may somehow be led astray from your sincere and pure devotion to Christ. So he references back to Eve. Think about that. Was Eve deceived? Yes, he said it. You know, she ate the piece of fruit, right? And then she gave it to her husband. But what did Satan say to her to get her to eat the piece of fruit? Did he say, oh, that's not fruit? Yeah, see, what he really said is he didn't kind of deceive. He planted a seed of, the perfect word, he planted a seed of doubt. That's exactly what Satan does to us as well. He plants a seed of doubt. And you're going to see what he plants the seed of doubt in mostly here in the scripture. But he planted a seed of doubt with Eve. He said, did God really say you shouldn't eat that? Or does he just not want you to get the knowledge of the truth of evil? Right? He just planted a seed of doubt. And then what it did was made her question what she knew God said. God said, don't eat it. Don't eat of that tree. You can eat of everything else, but don't eat of that tree. And what did Satan say? Did he really say that? That's all he did. It makes you stop and think. Just that little voice in the back of your head. Did he really say that, or did I hear something different? Did I hear something different? You know, I think I did. Because, you know, we all have our own sinful nature at birth, right? That's what the Bible says. So what happened is he created a little doubt. And then he says here in the scriptures that I believe that you may be getting deceived in the same way. You see, but I am afraid that just as Eve was deceived by the serpent's cunning, your minds might somehow be led astray from your sincere and devotion to Christ. And that's what I want to share with everyone watching this right now. You need to make sure, is your mind getting strayed away to the actions of this world, to something else that's not of God? Because that's all he has to do is just twist it up. Did God really mean you got to honor the Sabbath day? Did he really mean that every week? I mean, seriously, like every week? Did he really mean don't work? Or just kind of don't, you know, just work a little less? You know, Satan will do that. He'll throw something out. Did he really mean that? Or can I just do it my way and just believe in God a little bit? No, he really means it in Scripture. And you'll see that as time goes on. Today, it's going to be a nice lesson to really go through it. But as these scriptures and these studies go on, you're going to see God really means it. And he means business, just like he meant business back then. So let's keep going, though. Verse 4, it says, "For if someone comes to you and preaches another Jesus other than the Jesus we preached, or if you receive a different spirit from the spirit you received, or of a different gospel from the one you accepted, you put up with it easily enough." Look what this is saying. That someone back then, when the Bible wasn't even written yet, in the days Jesus walked the earth, at that time, obviously, people then were preaching another Jesus. And they had received a different spirit, because we know that there's one spirit of God, of Holy Spirit, right? But there's also spirits of Satan. Satan has spirits, and they may look similar for some reasons, because, you know, things good could happen to you and all kinds of great stuff. But you got to be able to determine what spirit is working with you or in you. It also says that there's a different gospel. The gospel of Christ is the good news of the kingdom of heaven. That's what the gospel is, right? So look, it says that back then, people were preaching another gospel and preaching another Jesus and having a different spirit. So if it was back then, what do you think the probabilities of it right now? Do you think there's another one out there? No, there's thousands of them out there. And it says, if someone comes to you and preaches another Jesus. Who does preaching? Ministers, preachers. So if it was happening back then, do you think it's happening today? Absolutely. It's happening at an enormous rate today. Why do you think there's so many churches out there? Why are there so many different denominations? I mean, we all supposed to be reading the same book, right? If we're reading the same book, why are there so many different beliefs in the same book? Right? Why? You know why? Because man will take what they read and put their own opinion behind it, beliefs and ideas and concepts, versus just reading what it says and obedience to that. So I've had people say, oh, yeah, but this is from Paul. Paul, you know, he's not the guy to read. You know, he's a false doctrine. He teaches false doctrine. Well, we're going to see what the Bible says about that. I've had people say that. So I can believe the Bible, but I just can't believe what he says, even though he wrote most of the books in the Bible. I can't believe that, so then you're going to have to take out a lot of stuff in the scriptures then. It doesn't make sense. But I've had people say that to me. But does that make sense from a biblical perspective? Now, we're going to look and see what the Bible says on it. But what we got to realize is that there's somebody in those days that were preaching another Jesus, preaching another spirit, and preaching about the wrong gospel. So if that was happening back when Jesus was alive, the probabilities of happening now, or this is actually right after he was alive, this is Corinthians, of course, after he died, not too long after, then extrapolate that out to thousands of years later, you know what's happening now. We can see it, it's evident. But you have to know. If you're watching this right now, you have to know the difference between truth and deception. And that's what these series are going to be going through. So let's go to the next scripture. Scroll down, 2 Corinthians, and we're going to start in verse 11, verse 13. Look what it says. Yep, chapter 11, verse 13. It says, "For such people are false apostles, deceitful workers, masquerading as apostles of Christ." And no wonder, for Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light. It is not surprising then that if his servants also masquerade as servants of righteousness, their end will be what their actions deserve. So let's break this down. Who's this talking to? For such people are false apostles. Well, aren't there people that call themselves apostles today? Well, let's look at just that one right there. If someone calls themselves an apostle today, think about what is an apostle. What is an apostle biblically? The people that walked with Jesus, his disciples that walked with him. So how is it possible to have an apostle today? I don't see Jesus walking around today. So how can some man today call himself an apostle? An apostle is only one person in the scriptures. Moses wasn't even an apostle. Not in scripture, right? Jesus was up there in the cloud. That's a whole other scripture, but he didn't even call himself an apostle. The only people that called themselves an apostle were the ones that physically walked with Jesus, Jesus called. That's it. Right? So you understand? Paul says, I'm not even worthy to be called apostle. He says that himself. And he was called directly by Jesus. Right? So how can a man today call themselves an apostle in Scripture? It doesn't make sense. So that's just a little deception right there. Now, I'm not saying what he teaches us, because I don't know the people that call themselves that. What I'm just saying is that even just that name doesn't make sense. But look what it says there. It says, and deceitful workers masquerading as apostles of Christ. What does it mean to masquerade? What does it mean to masquerade, Jay Nomadic? What does it mean? You guys know? Yeah, but walk around, Masquerading is kind of like, you know, you go to a party, and sometimes they put those little masks on. It's not maybe a full-on costume, but it's just like little glasses to make you look like somebody different. You know, you have, my kids have the one for Iron Man. Didn't you have Iron Man face or Iron Man head? Yeah, so he put like a little mask on his Iron Man head, right? And he masquerades around like he's Iron Man. He tries to play like Iron Man and jump off the bed and all kinds of stuff, right? Like Iron Man would. But is he really Iron Man? But he masquerades like he's Iron Man. So in the same way the Scripture says, these people are false prophets, deceitful workers, and they masquerade as apostles of Christ. So if that was happening back then, what do you think is going to happen today? Do you think that happens today? Yes, it's happening. Actors, yeah, they're pretending. Right. That's right. That's exactly right. And look what it says here. Look what it says. Keep going. Verse 15, it says, and it's not surprising. He ain't even surprised about it. So why should we be surprised? It's not surprising. Hopefully you're listening to this message. You're not surprised, because this is going to expose who you're listening to. I learned this 60 years ago, even in business. Who do you listen to? You know, because back then I was listening to a lot of people that were telling me I couldn't do this, I couldn't do that, and this and that, and I was listening to them. So now, you know, they redirect me to who you listen to. You need to listen to people that are teaching the truth, not false doctrine. And the same thing is, he says, not surprising, that if it, his servants, who's his? It says his servants. It's talking about Satan's servants. So in other words, Satan has servants also masquerade as servants of righteousness. So there's true people out there preaching the good news and the truth, and then there's some people out there teaching the false doctrine. But they look alike, because they masquerade as people of righteousness. They might, you know, talk the talk and walk around with big chests and got the big cars and the fancy stuff, and they look great. Looks great. But watch the doctrine that they teach. And you're going to start to see that as this message goes on. But the Bible says their end will be what their actions deserve. Okay? So it's really important to understand this. And so let's keep going, though. Let's see this. Matthew 3. Matthew 24. Matthew 24. Now, you got to understand, this is messages for you too, so you should be taking notes with this, because this is something that you need to be looking at and understanding as you're going through this as well. Matthew 24, starting in verse 3. Starting in verse 3, it says, as Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately. Tell us, they said, when will this happen? What will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age? Those are three separate questions he asked, and you know he wants to answer those questions. He wants to start answering those questions. So look what it says. Jesus answered, watch out that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name, claiming I am the Messiah, and will deceive many. So look what it says. It says, many will come in my name, claiming I am the Messiah, and will deceive many. Let me show you where this is a little bit of a deception that people teach, that have been taught. People think this is saying that many are going to come in his name, waiting, saying that they're a disciple, they're the Messiah. And there are people out there. If you look online, there's people out there that are saying, I'm the Messiah, I'm the Messiah, I'm the Messiah, you know, and they're walking around trying to act like they're Jesus. There are people that do that, but not many. There's a few, right? There's not many. But look what it says here. It says, many will come in my name claiming I am the Messiah. That's different. He didn't say, there's many coming in my name claiming they are the Messiah and will deceive many. That's not what it says. So you got to learn to read the Bible word for word what it says. It says, many will come in my name, Jesus' name, claiming that Jesus is the Messiah, and they will deceive many. You understand? So these are ministers. These are people preaching in Jesus' name, saying Jesus is the Messiah, and they're going to deceive many. You understand? Because of the false doctrine they'll be teaching. They'll be teaching another Jesus, another gospel, another spirit, just like it said in the last scriptures. This is very important to understand. Because this is now talking the last days. If you keep going down through Matthew 24, it's talking about what's happening in the last days. So we just now read it in two different ways. We read it when Jesus was walking around and right after he died. And now he's talking about it at the end. So you see, this is our time today. Because this is what's happening now. When you start reading about rumors and wars and all this stuff, you can see online, it's all happening now. So this is talking about now. This is one of the biggest signs that Jesus tells us to do, is to watch out that no one deceives you. Watch out that no one deceives you. And you, individually, that no one deceives you personally. Because it's your relationship with God that makes the difference. It's not a group, it's not our ministry, it's not the church, it's not my responsibility to make sure you're not deceived. Now, my job is to teach you the truth. It's your job to make sure that no one deceives you. And it's going to be through ministers. You understand? That's what the Bible says. It's not my opinion, I'm just reading the scriptures. You understand? So it's very important to grab this, because if you miss this, you will be deceived. We can almost guarantee it. As a matter of fact, let's look and see what the Bible says about that. Because maybe some are good enough to not be deceived. Maybe some of them are strong enough to not be deceived. Okay? So, but let's see what the Bible says about that. Let's go to Revelation. And Revelation is end times, right now. So let's look at what it says. Revelation 12, starting in verse 9. It says, the great dragon was hurled down, that ancient serpent called the devil, or Satan, who lead the whole world astray. He was hurled to earth, and his angels with him. So now, the Bible says that Satan leads the whole world astray. Not most of the world, not some of the world. It says the whole world astray. That would include us. You understand? That would include us. That would include you. So if the Bible says that Satan came, or Satan's here in Revelation, because we know that's the end times, who leads the whole world astray, then that's including us. That's why Jesus tells us to make sure that no one deceives us. Because many are going to come in Jesus' name, claiming Jesus is the Messiah, and are going to deceive many. You see how that works? It's very important. Going to deceive many. You understand? So it's very important that we understand this. So now we understand that the false doctrine and the false apostles are going to come, and they're here, and they're teaching this message. You got to be able to spot them and spot that false doctrine. For me, if it ain't in the Bible, then it's your opinion. That's how I look at it. If someone comes to me and says, I believe this, great. Write this down. The word belief means opinion if it's not backed up with scripture. Write that down. The word belief means opinion if you can't back it up with scripture. See, I can believe something. Let's say there's 10 of us sitting in this room, and we talk about a belief of something, a belief in a topic, and all of us go around and say what they believe about that topic. Okay. But then we open the Bible, and the Bible discusses that topic specifically and says something different than all 10 of us. Who's right? The Bible's right. That's the way it's supposed to be. However, it's not that way, because what will happen is, I believe it says this. My interpretation is this. Well, I believe it says this. Well, this is what I interpret it to be. That's where the problem comes. The word interpretation is not necessary. The Bible's pretty clear and easy to understand. He's not trying to confuse us. God's trying to make it simple for us to understand. He wouldn't give us a Bible that's so confusing that we couldn't get it. No, we have to have the heart to listen and read the Bible, read what it actually says, and obey it. A lot of people read what they think it says and read around it and not actually read the words that we just read. So it's very important to learn this, and that's why we're going through this message, so we can learn how to do this. Okay? So let's go now. Let's look at some of the deceptions. Number one, One deception that we have to build a foundation on is that the Bible was written by man. People believe that. The Bible was written by man. Man wrote the Bible, so I don't know if I can trust it. Man translated the Bible. That's even worse. Man translated the Bible so that, you know, we can't put our faith in the Bible because man translated it. Well, who would come up with that idea? That's Satan's plan. Of course, if you don't have a foundation of the Bible, then what is your foundation? If the Word of God in its entirety right now, if it's not the Word of God is not your foundation, then what is the foundation? Right? If you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything. So it's important to understand that we need to stand for something. And that's what Satan's number one thing. He wants to break the foundation. Right? The Twin Towers fell down when an airplane hit it. You guys think that's true? You think it fell down because two airplanes hit it? Well, if you go do the research, there's YouTube videos on it all day long, that there's never, ever in history of building buildings, a building has ever fallen down from fire. Ever. Yeah, and the way it fell down, it was a complete demolition. Go look up on video. Matter of fact, I may put it on the website of who actually knocked it down, because it wasn't the people you think it is. You're going to be blown away if you want to know that one. But I'm going to tell you right now, a building doesn't fall like that. And fire has never brought down a building. There's been buildings that burned for 24 hours and didn't fall. It's impossible for it to happen. And there's been many, many people that says it's impossible. But people believe it's true. Right? They believe that. So, same thing with the Bible. People believe the Bible was written by man. But it was written over four continents, over 40 different authors, over 1,500 years that almost have never met. Talking about the past, present, and future of the entire universe, and men think they wrote that. Men can write about what's happened in the universe, how the universe created, but it doesn't even make sense. You know, but people believe that man wrote the Bible. Well, let's see what the Bible says about the Bible, because that's what matters. So let's read 2 Timothy 3. And these scriptures are very important for you. As you're watching this right now, you start to learn this, you need to teach this. You need to learn it so well you can teach it to others. Because as you start meeting people, you're going to see some of the people that may have been teaching you are biblically wrong. They might be great people. I'm not questioning that. They may, you know, have a great heart and they really may love God. But that doesn't mean you're not deceived. So you need to learn this so you can share it with them. So hopefully they'll see the light of the truth of what's going on. So look at 2 Timothy 3. See what the Bible says about that. 2 Timothy 3, starting in verse 16. And again, when you read the scripture, you want to learn to read all of the scriptures. So let's look what it says. Starting in verse 16, it says, all scripture is God-breathed. So let's just stop right there so we don't confuse the issue. All scripture is God-breathed. How much scripture is God-breathed?
All.
Does that mean most? Some? 99.9%. No. So either the Bible is true or it's not. So all scripture means all scripture. You got that? It's real simple. See, Jesus is not trying to confuse us with the Bible. If the Bible says all scriptures God breathed, then all scriptures God breathed, and that's the end of it. No matter what you believe. See, and that's where the problem is. Could people believe that, well, this scripture is God breathed, but this one is written by man. I don't believe in this guy that wrote this Bible. And you understand? The Bible says all scriptures God breathed. So, you see, when I hear something that's not optional, the word all is not optional. All means all. It doesn't mean all but. There's no all but. It's all. So we got to put that as a conviction that when the Bible says it's all, then it's all. Sometimes the Bible says if. And if it's if, then it's optional. But there's certain scriptures that are optional. There's certain scriptures that's the end of it. Got it? So we got to believe. That's called by faith. See, that's when we read the Bible has to be written and lived by faith. Not by what you believe or what you've been taught, what you think you understand. No, what the Bible says is real clear. So if all scripture is God breathed, then all scripture is God breathed. And then it says that it's useful. It's not this book you put on the shelf. It's useful. We don't need all these other books to be satisfied scripturally. We need to just read this one. Now, there's a lot of other books that give good principles that you can use. But the Bible says it's useful. And let's see what it's useful for. It's used for teaching. Now, if we want to learn the Word of God, where's a good place to learn it from? the Bible. It's useful for teaching us how to live. It's God's manual that he gave us of how to live our life as a disciple of Jesus. So it's useful for teaching. It's useful for rebuking. Now, rebuking is like a strong correction. Like my son sometimes, if he gets on it, you know, goes over to the stove and wants to play on the stove, I'm going to say, stop playing on the stove because he can get hurt, right? What if he doesn't listen? Like some kids don't like to listen. My son is great, though. He loves to listen on the first time, right? Right. But anyway, rebuking. Rebuking means a stern correction. You know, it's like, you know, don't touch the stove. He doesn't touch the stove. Next time he goes over, whack the hand a little bit. You know, so he won't touch the stove. But it's not because I don't love him. It's because I do. Because I don't want him to get burned. And the Bible is useful for that, too. It also says it's useful for correcting. Now, correcting means that we might be going off track. See, we want to be going in a direction, but Satan's goal is to take us off track. You know, when I think about off track, if you think about a train, like we were coming here from Vegas, we took a unique route, a route we didn't know. We were lost, kind of, in a real way. We were not really knowing where we were going. But anyway, this train was going down the track. It was a really long train. Imagine if whoever built the track wanted to, they hated Amtrak or they hated the train system, right? And what they really wanted to just destroy anyone having to do with the train system. So they made the track down the road just a hair off, like 1 inch off. Not a lot, because, you know, a lot, if the train, there was no track there, it'd be too easy to see, right? But if they wanted to deceive that driver driving that train that was full of people, hundreds and hundreds of people, he wanted to get rid of them all he'd have to do is make the track off 1 inch. That's it. What would happen to the train if it was off an inch? The train would derail and fall off the track, right? That's right. And guess what would happen to the people? A lot of them will perish because of it. That's exactly what deception is. That's what Satan does. See, but the Bible makes the tracks perfect. It's perfect. The tracks are not off in the scriptures. It's when we read the scriptures and we throw it off because of Satan's deception that's taught us through his ministers, like it says in scripture. So you understand, the Bible is used to correct. Wait, you're off track a little bit, get back on track. You're off this way a little bit, get back on track. You know, but we have to read the Bible to get that. We can't go to man to get that. We have to go to the scripture, because man is off. Because of thousands of years of deception by his ministers. This is what we have to realize. But then it also says it's useful for training in righteousness. Training in righteousness. So if you want to get in shape for track, what do? You run track. You run and practice and train for track. If you want to get trained and be an excellent martial artist, what do you have to practice? You have to train and practice martial arts. If you want to get trained at writing a book, what do you have to practice? Writing. Does that make sense? So if we want to be trained in righteousness, what do we have to do? We have to read in the Bible. You understand? They practice reading the Bible. We can't just go to church, never read the Bible, but then we're going to be trained in righteousness. That doesn't make sense. How many churches do you know? How many people go to church every week? And go to church, even the sentence go to church makes no sense, biblically. Because biblically, when you're baptized for the forgiveness of your sin, you become the church. So how do you go to church? It's a building. You don't go to church. You are the church. So if anything, you're just congregating together. You understand? But the whole point is, see, people go to church, and they go, and then the minister puts up some scripture on the big screen, and no one actually reads their own Bible. That's why I give you the scriptures. I print them out so everyone here can listen to them and go over them for themselves. I tell you the scriptures, and I ask you, go read it in your own Bible. You don't have to believe me. I put these online so you can watch it and get the scriptures, so that we don't want you to have your faith in me. I don't want you, matter of fact, I can tell you right now up front, I don't want you to have any faith in me. I don't want you to believe anything I'm telling you. But what I do want you to do is believe what the scriptures are reading to you and what you're seeing in the scriptures. That's why I want you to take this message, write down the scriptures, go look at it in your own Bible and read it so that you can put your faith in God's word, not in me. Does that make sense? So it's very important to understand that. And it says it's useful. So it says this book is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, and here's why. So that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. See, if you want to be thoroughly equipped for the righteousness that God wants us to have, you're only going to get it one place, and that's in the Word of God. But Satan will tell you, that Paul guy, can't listen to him. He's a false doctrine. He teaches false doctrine. then how could you possibly be thoroughly equipped if he wrote most of the scriptures? Doesn't make sense. All that Old Testament, you don't have to read that Old Testament. That was the Old Testament. We go by Jesus, the New Testament. Well, the Bible says all scripture is God-breathed. It doesn't say half the scriptures are God-breathed. It doesn't say since Jesus came, that's scripture, and that's what's God-breathed. No, it says all. All means all. So you understand? See how the deception, how Satan just twists it just a little bit. Just takes that rail just off just a little bit. Just a little. That's deception. And that's what his ministers do to us. But see, what we've got to do, and what I'm calling you to do today, what the Lord is calling us to do, is to get back to the scriptures, reading the Bible. You need to take your own Bible. There was one time Jamie and I, we went to this church, a gigantic church out here in Orange County, California. I'm not going to mention any names, but you all know them because you probably already read the book. But we went to this big church, right? And when we were there, a friend of ours invited us, and minister was up there preaching, and they had the big screen. There's thousands of people in the room. We're sitting there. We got our Bible because we're trained to read our Bible. So the minister's going through these messages, and we're looking at it, and we're looking at the scriptures, and he's going through it, and they were all accurate until he said, what I want you guys to do is accept this prayer and pray this prayer so you can get your sins forgiven. And on that particular scripture, he didn't read any scripture. Every other part of the message, he actually put a scripture after it. But on this one part where he said, I want you to accept the Lord as your Lord and Savior and say this sinner's prayer and you're going to be saved. But on that particular scripture, there was no scripture. Now I'm looking for it now. I'm looking for, where's the scripture? What happened? There's no scripture. Why? Because there is no scripture on that. That's why. That's a false doctrine, which we'll go through another day. But ministers all across the world teach that. But there's no scripture behind it. Now the scripture they use for it, that's different. And we'll explain that a little later. But this is so important to understand that if you want to be thoroughly equipped for every good work, you need to go by the Bible. See, we were able to recognize the false teaching that that minister taught. And now after doing some research about him, we see a lot of false teaching that he's teaching. But that's another point. But the whole point, it was easy to see because we knew the Bible. We understood the Bible, especially about that particular point. You understand? So it's very important that you need to know it. You need to know it because you're going to start to see as this opens up, as this God's going to open up a can of worms, and you're going to start to see all the false doctrine that's being taught right now. Let's keep going now. The Bible is not written by man. Let's see what the Bible says about that. So we just read 2 Timothy. Let's now go to Hebrews. Hebrews 4. And we're going to start Hebrews 4, starting in verse 12. Hebrews 4, starting in verse 12, it says, for the word of God is living and active. We're going to stop right there. It says the word of God is living and active. So now this was written thousands of years ago, and we're reading it today, right? So if that's the case, the Bible says the Bible is living and active. It's not an old book. It's not something that was written years ago, like people have said. Oh, that's some good stories from back in the day. Well, that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says today that the Bible, or the Word of God, is living and active. Okay, so either it's living and active today. Will it be living and active in 100 years from now if the 100 years is still here, right? That happens. Yeah, what about last month? Was it living and active then? Yeah, see, the Bible says that it's living and active. This is the Word of God. So who's right now? The people that say, oh, this is an old book, or it's current and active now? It's living and active now. It says that it's sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to divide the soul and spirit, joint and marrow. Stop right there. It says this book that we read, the Bible, that we read it, it's so sharp that it can penetrate to divide the soul from the spirit. Think about that. Think about how powerful this book is, this Bible, God's Word. It says it's so powerful that it can divide your soul from your spirit. Let me ask you a question, and you think about this. Name one other instrument on the planet that can divide your soul from your spirit. Name one. Nothing. There's absolutely nothing on this planet that can separate your soul from your spirit except the Word of God, the Bible that we want, that the Lord wants you to put your faith in. You understand? This book can divide your soul from your spirit. That's pretty powerful, right? I mean, there's laser beams right now that can pull cancer out of you, that can get into your eye, the fine things of your eye. A laser beam could do that. But it can't divide your soul from your spirit. You understand? Now, it can cut out cancer, cut sin out of your life, cut cancer and junk out of your life, right? Make you feel better, you heal. But it can't divide your soul from your spirit. The reason I keep reiterating that is because the Bible is where we need to put our faith, in God's word. In God's word. There's no other book on the planet that ever said that they can divide the soul and the spirit. No book. No other religion. No other group of people that have a book that says they can divide the soul and the spirit. None. But the Bible says it can. That's why God wants us to put our faith in the word of God. And then it says it judges. The Bible judges the thoughts and attitudes of your heart. Now, you show me a book that can judge your thoughts and attitudes of your heart. There is no book on the planet that can judge your thoughts and attitude of your heart. None. No book. There's not a one. But the Bible says it can. So, do you think, now think about this logically, if the Bible can divide your soul from your spirit, if the Bible can judge the thoughts and attitudes of your heart, no matter what you say out here, we see that the facade that we see, if the Bible can judge the thoughts and attitudes of your heart, do you think it's important to read it? What do you think? Do you think it's important for you to learn it, not just read it, but learn it? What do you think about that? Do you think it's important not just to read and learn it, but to actually obey it? That's right. Yes, please listen to that, because we were using the Bible to teach the kids. And, you know, the Bible says we're all children. From a spiritual perspective, if you had your sins forgiven, you're part of the body, you're a child of God. So we need to have the same heart, that we use the scriptures to allow us to get taught and get trained and get, you know, in righteousness, like the Bible said. So that was a great example, great analogy for the kids. But we need to look at ourselves the same way. When we do something we know is not right, do we look back at the scriptures that we understand in our head and say, wait, am I going to do the right thing or am I going to do the wrong thing? Because the Bible judges the thoughts and attitude of our heart. But here's the next part. It says verse 13, and says, nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. We need to see that. Nothing's hidden. Not what you do in dark always comes to light. What you do in secret, the Bible says it exposes in the daylight. You see, you got to understand that nothing that you do or have done is hidden from God. Nothing. It says everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give account. Now look at what this says. Look how many absolute words are in here. Nothing in all creation. Everything is uncovered. So you got to realize, no matter what you do or what you don't do, the Bible is going to judge it. The Bible is going to see what you've done and what you haven't done, and it's going to be judged by that. Now people say, well, the Bible doesn't judge you. Jesus judges you. That's what people will say. Well, yeah, I'm not judged by that. I'm judged by, you know, living a good life. Well, let's see what the Bible says. We're going to go to 2 Peter 1. 2 Peter 1. And we're going to jump down to verse 20. 2 Peter 1, verse 10. 2 Peter 1, started in verse 1. I apologize. I don't know what I said. Yeah, 2 Peter 20. 2 Peter 1, verse 20. I'm sorry, guys. My head's not 100% right now. I apologize. 2 Peter 1, verse 20. It says, above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came by the prophet's own interpretation of things. Let's stop right there. It says, above all, you must understand. Above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came by the prophet's own interpretation of things. So, here's another one of those absolute words. Above all, you must understand. What does above all mean? Above anything else. Above anything you believe, above anything you've been taught, above anything of your own opinion or ideas, no matter how strongly they are, above anything that you've heard or thought of up to this point, above all, you must understand this. It's not optional. It's not saying you should understand it. It's not up for debate. The Bible says, above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture, no prophecy. See how many absolutes there are there? No prophecy of Scripture. Not one word of prophecy of Scripture has come about by the prophet's own interpretation of things. So there's no one in the Bible that wrote any words in this Bible that came because they thought of those words. That's what the Bible just said. So they didn't think of, you know, I think I need to tell this story about Noah. I need to tell that. No, you know, I think you need to write this story about what you should do and what you shouldn't do in the church. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible used people, but the Bible says not one of the words that came that was written in this book was written by the person who wrote the word in the book. It was written by God. That's what the Bible says. Now, what are you going to believe? That's the question. See, you can believe, remember the word belief, without opinion is just, and without Scripture is just your opinion. The Bible says that none of these words are written by man. And that's why we can put our faith in God's word. It says, verse 21, for prophecy never, not sometimes, not in the New Testament, never had its origin in the human will. But prophets, though human, spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is what carried them and got them to say and write what they wrote in this book. It wasn't their own. It wasn't their past history. It wasn't what they learned. No, it was what God wanted to be in this book. So here's why I could put my faith in it, is because if God wrote the entire book, then that's what I believe. Because everything else on this planet was written, done by man. It was created by man. Now, God put it here. Like, there's no, by the way, there's no such thing as man-made. Nothing. Man hasn't made a single thing on this planet. It was already here. Man just arranged it and put it together. You know, God already made the dirt. He made the air. He made the oxygen. He made all the molecules. He made everything. He was already here. What man did was just take it and put it together and mix it together and make it. He never said, let there be. There is nothing man's ever said, let there be. And it became. Nothing. So there's no such thing as man-made. It was all made by God. Now, God allowed men to do certain things and put stuff together and arrange it because he gave us free will. Man had never made anything. God made everything. So that's very important to understand. And we're carried by the Holy Spirit. Now, why is this so important? Why did I harp on this particular point so much? That's right. Before you build a house, what's the first thing you build? The foundation. You got to dig a hole. You know, not only do you have to dig a hole, you have to pull out a lot of dirt. You got to pull out a lot of dirt. But you know what? There's other things in that hole. Sometimes there's dead bodies. There's skeletons in the closet. Right? There's all kinds of stuff that's in that hole. Huh? Yeah, there's some stuff in that hole sometimes, right? That you got to dig out. You got to pull it out. And clean it up, get it nice and stable, ready to go, and then you build the house on top of it. Okay, but another thing about that, about building that foundation, here's another big analogy you got to understand. The bigger the building you're going to build, the bigger the hole needs to be, and the foundation needs to be more stable. If you're going to build just a little shack, you know, like a outhouse, you ain't got to build a big hole at all. You could probably just sit that there. But if you dig a little hole, it'll be a little bit more stable, right? But if you want to build a massive skyscraper, guess what you better do? Have a big hole and a lot of concrete in there, and a lot of wires and reverb, and make that thing solid as a rock, right? Before you start building that skyscraper. And biblically speaking, we're trying to become God's building, right? We're trying to make it to the kingdom of heaven, which is very high. Like a skyscraper is high, but nothing like getting to the kingdom of heaven. And if we want to be there, then we got to build a strong foundation. And that strong foundation that needs to be on the Bible. It needs to be on the Word of God. And that's why God put this on my heart to really reiterate this for you that are listening, for you that are here in this room, that if the Bible's not your foundation, then what is? Your own beliefs? What your minister taught you? What you read in all the 17 books you got sitting on your shelf? What's your foundation in? And what you've learned over the last 40 years? No. Your foundation needs to be on the Word of God because it's living and active. You understand? It's sharper than a double-edged sword. It was written by God 100%, not 99.9%. Here's another deception that people will say. Well,
Yeah, but the Bible is written, but what about those other scriptures that were taken out? Those other things that were taken out by this person, or what about these different translations? Some of them have missing scriptures, and which are all true. Well, the Bible says that if you take, you know, words out of this book, you'll get the plagues of this book. It says that in Deuteronomy. It also says in Revelation. It says if you take or add or subtract from the scriptures, there's going to be plagues. What it didn't say is that it's not going to happen. It didn't say no one's going to take words from the scripture. It says if you do, you'll receive the plague. So God already anticipated that people were going to take words and add words to the book. But that doesn't have anything to do because God allowed it to happen. You understand? So even though it says that, it doesn't make a difference. Because remember, the righteous will live by faith. You still have to believe that this book is the word of God. You still have to believe that. Even with all the stuff that's happened over the years, all the translations, all the scriptures that have been taken in and out, all the books that have been taken out, all that, we still got to believe that this book is the word of God. It was written by God. That's where your faith needs to be. So now let's look at a couple other ones here. Let's go to Ephesians 19. That's what I meant. Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians 2, and we're going to start in 19. Ephesians 2, starting in verse 19. It says, consequently, you are no longer foreigners and aliens. That's not what it says. Let's read it again. Verse 19. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household. Built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. Okay, so now we now can see what the Bible says is the foundation. We've been talking about a foundation and how it has to be strong, right? So let's look at what the foundation is built on. It says, we're now part of the fellowship of the fellow citizens with God's people and member of his household. So this is talking about the people that are part of God's household. Today, we're not going to talk about how to become part of that household. We're just now talking about, once you are part of it, what's the foundation of that household? That's all we're discussing today. So let's look at what it says. Built on. So we need to know what it's built on. It's built on the foundation of three things. Apostles, prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. So we talked earlier about what an apostle is. What's an apostle? People that walked with Jesus. So that's part of the foundation. It's in a place where the people that walked the foundation with Jesus, that walked around with Jesus, are located. What are prophets? What are prophets biblically? People, okay, I'll explain it. People that back in the Old Testament and in the New Testament prophesied about what the Bible was, what was going to happen, and in the scripture. Because that's biblical. Nowadays, everybody's a prophet. I mean, anybody can be a prophet in their mind. That doesn't mean they're a prophet. But the Bible was talking about in the Old Testament, the New Testament, because it's talking about the foundation of God's people. So in the Old Testament, the prophets, the New Testament, the prophets, the people that wrote the scriptures, the prophets, that's what it's talking about, and the apostles, the people that walked with Jesus. The third group of people, it says, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. Now, what is a cornerstone? We talked about building a skyscraper. If you're going to build a skyscraper, the very first brick you lay down is called a cornerstone. Because if that cornerstone is off, guess what happens to the building? It becomes the Leaning Tower of Pisa. That's what happens. The building is off. It's tilted over. It's off track, right? It goes the wrong direction because the foundation was off, because the cornerstone was off. In other words, the first brick. Well, who's the first brick of God's body? Of God's church? His church. No, it was actually Jesus. Jesus was the first and the last. He's the Alpha and the Omega. He is the first. So you understand, Jesus is the first brick of that foundation. So now let's ask the question, where on the planet can you find those three elements? The apostles, the prophets, as Jesus is the foundation of it. Where can you find that? Only one place.
The Bible.
The Bible. That's it. That's the only foundation right there. And it says it in scriptures. That's the only place you can find apostles, prophets, and Jesus in the same spot. One place. The Bible. So I hope you understand. That's what God wants us to know right now. He wants us to understand that if we don't put our faith in the Bible, then our faith is futile. It's useless. It doesn't make sense. You're never going to get it right without understanding the scriptures. So that's why we need to read these scriptures. So that's the first deception that Satan wants us to have. He doesn't want us to believe in the Bible. He doesn't want us to believe that God's word is 100% and he means what he says in that scripture. He wants to say, oh yeah, he means it, but I don't think you need to do this. Well, I don't think is your opinion, and it's wrong. You understand? My opinion is wrong. The Bible tells us exactly what he wants us to do. And we're going to go through just one today, one or two little teachings on that, because it's so important to see the deception now. So you got to understand, the Bible is the final answer. If all of us have our beliefs and opinions, and we see it in the scriptures are right. None of us are right, but the scriptures. That's it. So let's keep going now. This is the second thing that Satan wants to deceive us with, is that you can just have faith and believe in Jesus and be saved. That's a big one. That's why God put this one on my heart to talk about first. This is a big one. We're not going to go through all the details of it, but we're going to see some scripture, because we need to see the scripture, how they get that deception. Because it's in the scriptures that we do have to have faith, that we do have to believe in Jesus to be saved. The Bible does say that. And we're going to look at the scriptures of where that comes from and how Satan twists it. So let's look over at Romans 8. Romans 10, actually. Romans 10, starting in verse 8. Romans 10, starting in verse 8, it says, but what does it say? The word is near you. It is in your mouth, and it's in your heart. That is the message concerning faith that we proclaim. If you declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. As scripture says, anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame. Okay? So we're not going to read the whole thing, but that's a very powerful thing. And you know, that makes sense. As a matter of fact, we could preach that all around the world, that if you just confess with your mouth and you believe in your heart, you'll be saved. Because that's what the Bible says, right? Right. But the Bible also is in context. You have to read things in context. Because if you look at Romans 6, verse 1, it talks about baptism. It talks about repentance. There's many scriptures in there. So this is not a complete thought. He's just talking to people that already understand other parts to it. And you'll see that in scripture. But this is important. Do we need to have faith? Yes. The answer is yes. So write that down. If you want to be saved, if that's the end goal, you do need to have faith. And that's why it says the righteous will live by faith. But there's people that teach, all you have to do is have faith. That's all you have to do. You're saved by faith alone. Now, there's no scripture that says faith alone. There's a scripture that says you got to live by faith, but it doesn't say faith alone. Because if that's the case, then this wouldn't make sense. Here's why. Because it also says, it says that you have to confess with your mouth, right? Well, isn't confessing with your mouth something you had to do? Yeah. See, because faith, it's a mindset in your mind. Part of it is, but then there's also something you have to do, which is confess with your mouth. That's why it's so important to understand this, because people say, well, faith without deeds, you know, you're not faith saved by works. And the Bible does talk about that scripture. But you're right, we're not saved by the work, but we have to do the same work, or we won't be saved. So it says, if you declare with your mouth. See, remember that word now, it's if? What does that mean? It's optional. You don't have to do this, but then just don't expect to be saved. You understand? So it says, if you declare with your mouth, which means you don't have to. That's optional. But it's not optional to be saved. It's just optional. You don't have to believe in Jesus. So if you declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and if you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, then you will be saved. Okay, now the question is that all you have to do to be saved? No. Well, we're going to let the Bible talk about that next week. We're going to go into deep in detail on that. But this is very important to understand, that those two things, we have to have the faith and the belief and the deeds of doing the actions at the same time. All of it goes together. So, very, very, very important. Let's look at what the truth of the Bible says. Because we're going to look at a few of them, and then next week we're going to be building on top of this. Now we're going to see how Satan twists scriptures. Because there's a lot of people, there's people, millions around the world, that says this is all you have to do to be saved. Confess it in your mouth and believe it in your heart and you'll be saved. See, the Bible says it. Absolutely, the Bible says it. But the question is it complete? That's what we're going to look at now. So let's look at now what Jesus says out of his own mouth. This is John 8. And we're going to start in verse 31 and 32. John 8, starting in verse 31. So if you read a little bit before, it talks about how all these people were following him, the Jews and Gentiles all following Jesus. But look what Jesus says in verse 31. It says, to the Jews who had believed him. So who is he talking to? To the Jews who believed him. He weren't talking to the ones who didn't believe in him. So they should already be saved based on the scriptures, because it says, if you believe in Jesus, you're saved, right? Well, they believed in him. But let's see what it says. Jesus says, if you hold to my teaching, then you are really my disciple. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. You see that? It's three parts. It says, first, we have to hold to his teaching. And then you'll be a disciple of Jesus. The Bible says that Satan has disciples. And guess how you become one of Satan's disciples? By holding to his teaching. You understand? The Jews had disciples. Anybody can have disciples. If you hold to my teaching, you'll be my disciple. Now, I don't want that to happen. Let me just make sure we're clear on that. I don't want you to hold to my teaching. I want you to hold to the Bible's teaching, Jesus' teaching. But see, whoever's teaching you hold on to is whose disciple you are, biblically. In other words, if you hold on to your minister's teaching, regardless of what the Bible says, then whose disciple are you? Your minister's teaching. If you hold on to the Pope's teaching, or some religious leader's teaching, and they teach you something, and the Bible says something different, and you feel like you should hold on to their teaching more, guess whose disciple you are? Their disciple. Because Jesus says, if you hold to my teaching, then you're really my disciple. See, some of those people were not really Jesus' disciple, even though they believed in him. That's why he had to say this sentence. See, if you hold to my teaching, then you're really my disciple. If you hold to their teaching, then you're really their disciple. I hope you get this. So one of the things that we have to do, in addition to confessing with our mouth and believing in your heart, is we got to hold to Jesus' teaching. Not to the teaching we believe, what we've been taught in our past, what we grew up with, what the minister teaches us every week, what we watch on television and send in our $20 for the little piece of string. You know, those types of things. I'm laughing about that because we've done that. So we know people have done that very closely here. So, yeah, so it's very important to understand that if you hold to Jesus' teaching, then you're really his disciple. And that's the goal. But let's see what it says. They answered him, we are Abraham's descendants and have never been slave to anyone. How can you say that we'll be set free? So these are, you know, these people said they've never been slaves. I'm not going to talk about that today. We'll do that another day. But it says if they've never been slaves, then these people that are calling themselves Jews are not Israelites. They can't possibly be Israelites because all Israelites were slaves at that time. But let's keep going. It says, Jesus replied, very truly I tell you, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now the slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. So now it's talking about being freed from sin. So everyone sins and falls short of the glory of God. But it says here that if you hold to his teaching, then you'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free from sin. So we're going to discuss in the next, you know, not today, but we're going to go over how the Son sets you free from sin. Because you need to understand how that's done, because there's a lot of deception on that teaching. But the big thing you got to realize is that Jesus says, if you hold to his teaching, then you'll become a disciple, which is the second step. After you become a disciple, then it says, then you'll be freed from sin. But how? How is that done? And that's what we're going to be looking at. Let's look at another scripture on this. Because holding to his teaching is very, very important, but it talks about becoming a disciple. So let's see if that's important to God. Because nowadays, some people are starting to understand the word disciple, but most people have just been Christian. Just been a Christian. Did you know in the Bible that the word Christian is only mentioned three times? in the entire Bible. The word disciples mentioned hundreds of times, over 200 times. But Jesus says he wants people to be a disciple, not a Christian. Because a disciple is a follower. Today, you go ask 100 people in a room, are you a Christian? If they believe in Christ, Jesus, I'm a Christian. They'll be that committed. Yeah, I'm a Christian. Live in any way that they want to live. Never read the scriptures. Don't follow the scriptures. They believe in their own teaching or whatever they want to do, but they call themselves a Christian. But biblically speaking, he's looking for disciples. So let's see, Matthew 28. Matthew 28, starting in verse 18. Actually, starting in verse 16. This is right before Jesus ascends to heaven. Now, if it's right before Jesus ascends to heaven, do you think it's pretty important? What do you think? Yeah, it's pretty important, huh? So look what it says, verse 16. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Think about that. Imagine you out there with Jesus. Jesus, you saw him die on the cross. You saw him raised to the dead. You saw him walking around. He had a hole in his hand. He's walking through walls, doing different things, right? You see him, but it says some still doubted. How a lack of faith is that? I mean, he just did right in front of you, and he still doubt. But how many of us doubt today after we've seen all the miracles he's done? After you see what the scripture teaches and it's coming to fruition? After you see the miracles that have been in your life that God's been leading you maybe to him, and you still doubt? See, people still doubt today. Then it says, in verse 18, it says, then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. So now, this is Jesus talking to the disciples right at the end, right before he goes to heaven. I'm sure what he's about to say is the most important thing he wants to leave them with. A powerful message. He says, therefore go and make disciples of all nations. In other words, people that are following him, followers of Christ. Go make disciples, a follower of Jesus. And then he says to baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. That's the second thing he tells them to do. The third thing he says, in teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. Not some of the things. Teach him to obey everything he's commanded. So here's the question. What did he command them to do? Well, we'll talk about that. We're going to look at the scriptures on that in the next week or so. Because you need to know what he commanded you. What he commanded the disciples that we should be taught right now. So it's three parts. So now, I guess, just having faith alone doesn't make sense anymore. Because the Bible says go make disciples, a follower. So faith alone doesn't matter, doesn't make sense. What about faith in Jesus and believing it in your heart and you'll be saved? Does that make sense now based on what we just read? No, because there's more to it. Now we have to become a disciple of Jesus, follow him, baptize him, and get baptized for the forgiveness of our sin, and we need to obey what he teaches. So there's more than just faith alone. Faith alone is how Satan twists the scriptures to get people all around the world to believe they're saved. But biblically, they're not. That's deception. Many will come in my name, claim that I am the Christ, and they will deceive many. That's what he just did. When people believe that's taught, just accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, say the sinner's prayer. By the way, ask the minister, where's the sinner prayer in scripture? Can you show me a scripture in the Bible, someone saying the sinner's prayer and getting my sins forgiven and getting saved? Can you show me a scripture? Now ask your minister that question. Ask, if I confess with my mouth and believe in my heart, I'll be saved. Can you show me anyone in the scriptures after Jesus died that did that? Can you show me that anywhere in scripture? You won't find that in scripture. Here's why. Because it's deception, biblically. Because if it was a deception, wouldn't I just show it to you right now? I'm trying to help you in scripture. If it was in the scriptures, I'd show it to you in the scriptures right now because I want you to know the truth. I'm not trying to deceive you on it. I'm exposing the deception through the word of God. So it's very important to understand this, that you must become a disciple of Jesus. Do you think it's important for a disciple to read the Word of God? Yeah, because it's useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness so the man of God could be fully equipped for every good work. So it's impossible to build that foundation without reading the Scriptures and understanding it. The last scripture we're going to go through is Luke 14. Not today. Luke 14. It's a long one. It's a really long one. Luke 14. Luke 14, starting in verse 25. Now it's talking about the cost of being a disciple. It says, large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father, his mother, his wife, his children, his brother and his sister, yes, even his own life, such a person cannot be my disciple. So let's stop right there. So I want you to think about this. Everybody watching this and listening to this. This is what the Bible says. This is not what I said. It said they were following Jesus. Now, Jesus obviously wants everyone, all men to be saved and get to come to the knowledge of the truth, like the Bible says, right? That's what the Bible says. But you got all these people following him. Now, think about this bold statement. He's saying if it's optional. You don't have to follow Jesus. However, if you're going to follow Jesus, you've got to do what it says. Look what it says. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father, his mother, his wife, his children, his brother, his sister, yes, even their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple. So, you know, Jesus is now telling you, you got to hate your mother and father, sister, brother, your whole family, your whole life. You have to hate it or you can't even be his disciple. How many ministers taught you that deal? How many of those congregations with 30, 40,000 people saying you got to hate your family, your life and everything or you can't be my disciple? How many people have told you that message? Probably not too many. But that's what the Bible says. So who's right? The Bible's right. Not just Jesus loves everyone. No, that's not. He says you got to hate everyone or you can't be his disciple. Now, do you really believe Jesus meant hate? No. What did he mean? Well, let's see if the Bible will answer that question. Let's look at BibleGateway.com again. By the way, I like to use BibleGateway.com. It's an easy way to find scripture. But look at Matthew. I think it's Matthew 10. I think it's Matthew 10. See, let the Bible answer that question. What does he mean by hate? Matthew 10. Let's look at verse 37. Verse 37, it says, anyone who loves their father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves their son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever does not take up their cross and follow me is not worthy of me. So now what does that scripture mean? Does it really mean you have to hate your mother, father, sister, brother? No, it means you need to love Jesus more than your mother, father, sister, brother, even your own life, or you cannot be his disciple. That's what he's saying. See, because if your mother has a background of a certain religion or a certain teaching, and you love your mother more than Jesus, if Jesus says one thing in the scripture and your mom says something else, who are you going to follow? Your mom became your minister all of a sudden, became your leader, became your Lord. What about your minister? If your minister has a different teaching than what the Bible says, that's part of the world, that's what the Bible's saying, right? If that's the case, and teach something different, who are you going to follow? The Bible says you need to follow Jesus more because he is the life. You understand? If something you've learned in the past from your father, your mother, your children, if you love your family so much and they don't want to go to church, what are you going to do? You understand? So this is why he says you got to love him more than everyone. But here's the big question. How many of your ministers are now teaching that message? How many times have you heard that type of lesson? You don't hear that very often. Very few will teach that. Why? Because, you know, just like in Jesus' day, when you read this, a lot of them fled off after that. They say, oh, that's too hard for me. I can't do that. That's why he gives the option. If. It's optional. You don't have to. But if you want to be a disciple of Jesus, this is what you have to do. Let's keep reading though. It says, and anyone who does not carry their cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Now let's read what that means now. He gives them analogies. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Won't you first sit down and estimate the cost to see if you have enough money to build to complete it? In other words, if you're going to build a big skyscraper, you better have the money in the bank or at least the loan and the credit to be able to get it, because if not, you ain't going to be able to finish that building. Right? Same thing with walking with God. You got to make sure right now, while you're watching this message, that I'm going to follow Jesus and I'm going to finish the race. You got to make sure of that in advance. That's why the Bible says this. It says, for if you lay the foundation and are not able to finish, Everyone who sees it will ridicule you, saying this person began to build and was not able to finish. In other words, you start going to church, you start reading the scriptures, you start get baptized for the forgiveness of your sin, but then you didn't estimate the cost. You didn't say, this is a lifelong decision. This ain't a, I'm going to try it out and see if it's going to work program. No, Jesus is a decision you got to make. That's why you can't just go to some weekend seminar, say the holy prayer and get your sins forgiven, and then all of a sudden you can go live any way you want. No, he says you better count the cost, because if not, you're going to look like an idiot when your family looks at you and looks and sees how you live, how the way you live is nothing like what the Bible teaches, and it'll call you a hypocrite. That's what the Bible will say. You see, so you better count the cost. It's not just this snap decision. You listen to this message and you're going to say the Lord's Prayer all of a sudden, and then all of a sudden you're saved. It doesn't work that way. There's nowhere in Scripture that teaches that. You got to count the cost. Let's keep going, though. It says, suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Won't he first sit down and consider whether if he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming with 20 against him with 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the others are still a long way off and ask for terms of peace. So he's talking about two kings. One king has 20,000 men. The other one has 10,000 men. What he's talking about here is God and his angels with, you know, tens of thousands of angels versus you and your own beliefs, opinions, and ideas. Having 10,000 men. He's even giving you 10,000 men. What's the probability of you going after that army? One army got nuclear weapons. You got strings with, you know, rubber band on it. You're going to fight. What he's saying is going against God is silly. That's what this message is saying. Going against God is silly. You're going to lose. Right? But it says you can ask for a delegation to go out there and while God is still a long way off, while the great tribulation is still a long way off, which is not that long no more. It's right here. It says, while it's a long way off, and ask for terms of peace. Who is the person, the mediator between God and man? Who is that? That's Jesus. So we have to be right with Jesus if we want to make it to the kingdom of God. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No one gets to the Father except through him. That's what this message has said. It's a parable. Parables are taught so that, one, for the people that want to obey God can learn it, and it's also made for the people that are not wanting to obey God, they can't understand it. That's what the scripture says. But look what it says, the last part. In the same way, those of you who do not give up everything cannot be my disciple. Not just anything, everything. If you're not willing to give up everything, you cannot be his disciple. In other words, if you're not willing to hate your mother, your father, your sister, your brother, even your own life, you cannot be my disciple, even if you believe you are. Your belief is irrelevant. It's an opinion. This is backed up by Scripture. The Scripture says, if you're not willing to give up everything, you can't be a disciple. Here's the proof of the Scripture. Remember the rich young ruler? The rich young ruler came to Jesus and said, what must I do to get eternal life? First thing Jesus says is obey the commandments. The second thing he says after that is sell everything and follow me, which is actually the last commandment of the Ten. That's what he says in Scriptures. So you understand? If you're not willing to give up everything, you cannot be his disciple. So here's the question for you. Are you willing to give up everything? Your own beliefs, your own ideas, your own teaching, your own false doctrine that we've all been put under. That's what we had to look at in our life. All the false doctrine that we've had been taught. Are we willing to look at that? We wrote a whole list of all the teachings that we were learning and all the teachings that God, Satan had deceived us with. And we had to give all that up. We had to leave. We went to our minister and asked, hey, this is something the Bible says, but you're saying something different. Oh, and the ministers told me you need to obey this one, which was the doctrine of the church. But it was different than what the scripture said. So we had to leave. We had to get out of there. I pulled me and my family, and we had to go. Because we are going to obey God. We're going to obey God's word. But how about you? How about you listening to this right now? Are you willing to do that? Are you willing to die to yourself, hate everyone, not hate, of course, love them less than Jesus? Because if not, the Bible says you cannot be his disciple. And these are just a couple of the basic deceptions, but the foundational deceptions that we have to come to before we can start building a building. Because God wants us to dig all that dirt out. God wants us to dig all the junk in the foundation out, all the garbage, all the false doctrine, all the false teaching, all the false beliefs and understandings that we've been taught. He wants us to get that out so you can learn the truth, so the truth can set you free. So next week, we're going to be talking about some additional deceptions of Jesus' teaching. And we're going to talk about what Jesus' teachings are, and we're going to go through what it takes to get be saved and what it takes to get your sins forgiven. So I'm going to go ahead and end it off in a prayer, and we'll be done for today. Father God, I just want to thank you so much for today. I thank you so much for this lesson. I pray that the people that listen to this message have open ears and, most importantly, open hearts, that they want to learn the truth and come out from Satan's deception. Satan is a monster. He's unbelievable how he knows the Bible just as good, if not better, than we do. And he teaches us those little things to take us off track so that we can, you know, fall short of the glory of God and not make it to the kingdom of heaven. God, Father, I pray that you really inspire everyone that heard this message today to listen to it again. It'll be online as soon as possible. It'll be up so you can listen to it and they can hear it for themselves again and really take heart to it. Father, I pray for so many people around the world that you take this message and somehow get it go viral. Get everybody here to send it out to the people they know, the people they trust, and the people they love, so that everyone can hear this message. I thank you so much for all the blessings you do for us, all the ways you take care of us, Father. And I pray for everyone can have a great, blessed Sabbath day. We love you so much. It's in Yeshua's name we pray. Amen.